Hey, did you just finish watching that L405, L5S1, disc bulge best exercise video, or perhaps that video about best exercises for L405 disc bulge? I know I have some on my channel and there's many on other channels. And do you actually have an MRI report about your lumbar spine that diagnosed that L405 disc bulge or the L5S1 disc bulge? And are you wondering what the MRI actually means? Well, in this video, I'm gonna actually review many of the MRIs that I've received in my office through email and private message and actually teach you what the actual terms inside the MRI report means. Like this, you can understand what your MRI report means if you have these similar terms. And I'll use some spine models to actually demonstrate this. And this will be a new series on my channel, which will be called, What Does My MRI Mean? So stay tuned. Hey there, I'm Dr. Walter Salubro. I'm a corrective care chiropractor in Vaughan, Ontario, Canada. And what this channel is about is giving you tips and strategies on how to stabilize and correct your spine. Like this, you can bend, move, and lift normally without pain limitation. I also teach people on corrective chiropractic care in case that's something you're interested in pursuing. So if you want these tips and strategies, you want to learn about corrective chiropractic care, tap on the subscribe button below and the notification bell. Like this, you don't miss out on my weekly video updates. Also, if you're new to my channel, let me know that you subscribe and I'll personally reply back with a thank you. So in this brand new series on my channel called What Does My MRI Mean? I'm going to go over some of the terms that are commonly used on the MRI report. And a lot of them are similar, so I can actually look at 10 MRI reports and they may have similar terminology. So this will cover the span of many people watching my channel. But I'll start off with this report here, and I've highlighted four yellow sections I'm going to talk about, okay? And this is a lumbar MRI, and I'm going to talk about these terms and then tell you what they mean and show you on a spine model what it looks like. Also, be sure you watch right to the end, because one of the most commonly asked questions I get asked is, Dr. Walter, you make a lot of sense, but how do I find a chiropractor that does corrective care on the spine to actually correct these problems that I found on my MRI? And if you want that, then watch right to the end, because I'll refer you to a directory of corrective care chiropractors and hopefully you can find one in your area. So let's get right into the report right now. Okay, so I'm not gonna read the entire report, okay? But let me go over some of the highlights, okay? Some of the yellow highlights right there of what this report is saying. So it says here at L3, L4, disc space is slightly desiccated. The word desiccated, what does that mean on your MRI report? Well, so let me show you what normal is, okay? So here's normal, a normal disc, annular fibers, nucleus pulposus, nice disc height, and the disc is a protein cartilaginous fibrous structure with a nucleus jelly-like pulposus in the inside, and it's very well contained, and it holds lots of water. 90% of the content of the disc is water, okay? When there is degeneration of the disc and the actual disc height begins to decrease, so now here's another one. So see the difference here? So high disc height and it's beginning to decrease. As the disc height decreases, it begins to dry up. It loses water content. And over time, it will go into something like that. So see the difference here? So this is now a desiccated disc. What that means is that the disc is losing its water content, right? Now look at this one. This is an advanced desiccated disc right there. Quite different than the normal one, okay? So check this out. So normal and very dried desiccated disc. So if you hear the word desiccated disc or disc desiccation, it means that the disc is dehydrated to some degree. It's lost its water content. So what about the next one? Number two, there's irregularity to the end plate next to the narrowed disc. What does end plate irregularity mean or refer to? So again, let's go to the models. I think it's very helpful to have these models. So normal disc. So the nice well-contained disc, right? So the end plate of the vertebral body is the flat part in there. So I can lift the model up, but the flat part in there, that's the end plate. And there are fibers in the end plate that attach to the disc, right? And it keeps everything contained. So things are not moving, right? Things need to be stable. So when the end plate edges that on the MRI or on the actual x-ray, become degenerated. So let's say like this. So see the degeneration over here. This is called end plate irregularity, okay? So the end plate of the vertebral body is becoming irregularly shaped compared to normal. That's a sign of arthritis, degeneration, or disc degeneration affecting not just the disc, but also the end plate of the vertebral body. So basically arthritis degeneration at that disc level. Okay, let's go to bullet point number three. On the MRI report for the lumbar spine, it says mild narrowing of the right and left lateral recess bilateral, or sometimes they'll say something to the effect of intervertebral foramina is showing narrowing or neuroforaminal stenosis. Those terms, what does that mean? Okay, so again, let's go to our model here. So if we look at the spinal model, lumbar spine, straight from the front, elliptical curvature from the side. Here are the spinal nerves. They come out from this opening here, this opening where I'm putting my pen in, that's called a neuroforamen. So windows and opening where this nerve comes out of. There's nerves, there's blood vessels, fat tissue in here. And this foramen, this opening where the pen is right there, it needs to be wide, it needs to be wide so that nerve is not being compressed or irritated, okay? So now let me show you that on an actual individual spinal model over here. So right there, neural foramen, wide open, the disc is not compressing on the back and the nerve's not being compressed or irritated, right? So what does it look like when there's neural foramen narrowing or stenosis? So look at the difference here. Okay, so let's open this up here. Okay. Open neural foramen and now more closed right there. See that? Right there. So that nerve is being compressed and that opening where that nerve is a lot more narrower. So narrower, that means less space for the nerve to come out of being irritated and compressed. And as you're probably aware, you don't want your nerves in your body to ever be compressed because they carry electrical and chemical signals that feed life to your body and to your systems. So the nerves of the lower lumbar spine go to the bladder, the sex organs, they go to your legs, right? So people talk about sciatica, leg pain, or numbness and tenderness of the legs. When there's neuroforaminal stenosis, one of the clinical relevancy about that is that it could cause leg pain, sciatica leg pain, or numbness and tenderness of the legs, eventually possibly even muscle weakness or atrophy in the legs, which is very, very not good. So that's what neuroforaminal stenosis is, or narrowing of the neural foramen. It's when that opening there gets squished or compressed because of disc bulge. So here's an example, a disc bulge is narrowing the foramen, or arthritis degeneration. So the next finding, bullet point number four on this particular report says L5 vertebra is transitional in nature. So if your report says transitional in nature, or L5 transitional segment, or partial transitional segment, or lumbarization of the sacral segment, S1, or sacralization of L5, that's all the same thing. It means there's a transitional segment. What that means is this. Let's go back to the lumbar model. So lumbar spine normally has five vertebrae, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and it sits on the sacrum. The sacrum itself is a fused bone, but originally it was five vertebrae also. So S1, S2, S3, S4, S5. So five bones became one, right? They're fused, it's solid. When this doesn't delineate and become its own bone and it becomes part of the sacrum, it becomes sacralized, for instance. So that's called the transitional segment at L5. So it just means it's usually an incidental finding. We don't go looking for them. X-rays, I pick them up all the time, I find these. So the MRIs will find it as an incidental finding. In some cases, there could be some clinical relevancy, in some cases not, depending on the scenario and the alignment of the spine. But so when that L5 becomes fused with the sacrum because of a congenital variation in how the bones are formed and joined and so forth, that's called the transitional segment, okay? So lumbar transitional segment, that's what that refers to. So I hope you found this first segment of what does my MRI mean useful. I just went over some of the main findings of this particular report. And if you have any questions about particular MRI findings, let me know in the comments below. I can't give you any prognosis or recommendations of your particular finding because I didn't examine you, so I can't tell you what to do. But clarifying terms is not giving someone any clinical prognosis or recommendation, okay? And also, what do you do when you have a bad back, or you have a disc bulge, or there's degeneration on your disc and it's causing you some problems with back pain, leg pain, or limited mobility, and it's just destroying your life and quality of life? Well, you need to get that corrected. You need to find out if there's any alignment problems with your spine, any posture distortions that can be related to that. And as a corrective care chiropractor, that's what we do all day long in my office. I'm actually sitting or standing right inside of one of my adjusting and adjusting rooms, and then I have my structural rehab room right across the hall there. And I'm at the end of the day, so I'm doing this video right now for you. But if you're looking to actually get this assessed by a corrective care chiropractor or a chiropractor that's focusing on spinal correction, and you want to try to find one in your area, just comment below, ask me below in the comments, and I'll send you to a directory of an online directory of chiropractic corrective care chiropractors. There's lots in the United States. There's many in Canada. Some are in the United Kingdom and also in Australia and other parts of the world. But if hopefully you can find someone in your area. Okay, so just ask me in the comments below. And do like and share this video. Someone else may find it useful. It does help with the YouTube algorithm. And if you want to get some exercises and learn more about the anatomy of disc bulge, and you want to learn some exercises to help with a disc bulge injury or even relieve some of the pain, go to this video right here, right now, to continue learning. And you learn some of these four exercises and also some more information about the disc, anatomy of the disc and why it causes pain right here. So go get those exercises right there.